In the previous lecture, we have started to discuss the propagation of plane electromagnetic wave in free space. Actually, you have seen that solving the Maxwell's field equations in free space, we have got wave equation in terms of electric field vector E and magnetic field vector H. And taking the plane wave solution of that equation, we have find the speed of electromagnetic wave in free space, which was actually equal to speed of light, which were already known by different experiments. And since speed of electromagnetic wave in free space was equal to speed of light in free space, so Maxwell claimed that light might be an electromagnetic wave. And in fact, from the form of the plane wave solution, we have derived two operators, which were gradient operator del equal to ik and del del t equal to minus I omega. Here k is the propagation vector, or you can say wave vector, and omega is cyclic frequency of the wave. And after the use of these two operators, Maxwell's equations in free space were in a new form, and those equations I have mentioned here, which were derived in the first lecture, in this equation one. And these equations are k dot e equal to 0, k dot h equal to 0, k cross e equal to omega mu naught h, and minus k cross h equal to omega epsilon naught e. So now you can say these are the four Maxwell's equations of electromagnetic wave in free space. Actually, these form of Maxwell's equations are most convenient to discuss its different properties while propagating in free space. So now let us start to discuss the different properties of this wave when it is propagated in free space. The first property I would like to discuss is, in free space, electromagnetic wave is of transverse nature. You know, a wave is in fact called transverse wave when oscillation takes place perpendicular to the direction of wave propagation. And in this case, electric field vector and magnetic field vector oscillates, and you will see that these two vectors oscillate actually in a direction perpendicular to the direction of propagation of wave. And so it is said that in free space, electromagnetic wave is transverse. And it is clear from equation 1a and 1b. You can see from here what equation 1a reads. Equation 1a reads that k dot e equal to 0. And you know, if the scalar product of two non-zero vectors is 0, then definitely these two vectors are perpendicular to one another. So we can say this equation k dot e equal to 0 implies that the propagation vector k is perpendicular to e. It means electric field oscillates in a direction perpendicular to the direction of wave propagation. And similarly, you can see from equation 1b, which is k dot h equal to 0. And since k dot h equal to 0, so you can say that k is perpendicular to h. So what we see here? We see that both the electric field vector E and the magnetic field vector H are oscillating in a direction perpendicular to the direction of wave propagation. So we can say that electromagnetic wave in free space is of transverse nature. Now, the next important property of this wave traveling in free space is the three vectors, electric field vector E, magnetic field vector H, and the propagation vector K, are orthogonal. You know what does the term orthogonal means? If you say that EH and K are orthogonal, it means these three vectors are mutually perpendicular to one another. And it is evident from equation 1C and 1D. See here, equation 1C is what? This is K cross E equal to omega mu naught H. And equation 1D is minus K cross H equal to omega epsilon naught E. You know from definition of cross product of two vectors that if A cross B is equal to C, then C is actually perpendicular to both A and B. So in this case, you can say that if K cross E is equal to omega mu naught H. Since omega and mu naught are scalars, positive scalars, so it does not affect the direction. So in this condition, we can say that the vector H will be perpendicular to the plane containing the vectors K and E. And when you say H is perpendicular to the plane containing K and E, it means what? It means H is perpendicular to K and H is perpendicular to E also. And in a similar manner, equation 1D states that minus K cross H is equal to omega epsilon naught E. And so you can say that this vector E is perpendicular to the plane containing the vector K and H. It means E is perpendicular to K and E is also perpendicular to H. So what we are seeing here, we can see that E is perpendicular to H, K is perpendicular to H, and K is also perpendicular to E. And in a plane electromagnetic wave, we know that E and H are oscillating perpendicular to one another, which is also evident from here. So in this condition, we can say that these three vectors are mutually perpendicular to one another, because we must not be confused that when we say that it is a transverse wave, it means E and H both are perpendicular to K. So one can think that E and H are oscillating in same direction and both are perpendicular to K, but not. It is the fact that E and H both are perpendicular to K, but simultaneously E and H are also perpendicular to one another. And hence we say that E, H and K form an orthogonal system. In fact, this fact I have shown here in this figure. Let us consider a plane containing the vector E and H, and this plane is in fact XY plane. Here vector E is parallel to X axis, vector H is parallel to Y axis. In this condition, actually the wave is propagated in Z direction, and so K is perpendicular to both E and H, and simultaneously E and H are also perpendicular to one another. So we can say that these three vectors E, H and K are perpendicular to one another. Now we will discuss a most important property of this wave traveling in free space, and this property is that the two electric vectors E and H, not electric vectors, but the electric field vector E and the magnetic field vector H oscillate in same phase. You can say E and H are in same phase. When we say that E and H are in same phase, what does it mean? Actually, it means magnitude of E and H may be different, but during the oscillation, whenever E will be maximum, at the same moment H will be also maximum. When E is minimum, then H will be also minimum. When E is zero, then H will be zero. So in this condition we can say that these two vectors are actually oscillating in same phase in electromagnetic wave traveling in free space. And what is the condition to find this very fact that these two vectors are oscillating in same phase? Actually, we know that if the ratio of the magnitude of the these two vectors is real and positive, only then we can say they are oscillating in same phase. So in this heading, we will prove that the ratio of the vectors, magnitude of vectors E and H is real and positive. And after that, you can say that the vectors E and H are oscillating in same phase. And to prove this result, let us start with equation. Let us see here. We will start with the equation 1C. So from equation 1C, what does the equation 1C states? It states that K cross E is equal to omega mu naught H, omega mu naught H. And so from here we can find expression for H, and what will be it? You can see this will be K cross E over omega mu naught, omega mu naught. Now we know that, or you can say we have considered that this wave vector K is in the direction of wave propagation, and if we assume that this propagation takes place in a direction of unit vector n hat, then we can write it in this way. This will be K n hat cross E over omega mu naught. Here n hat is a unit vector in the direction of propagation vector K. And let us simplify this equation to some extent. So we can write H equals, sorry, this is H. H equal to, we have just obtained that this H will be equal to what? We can write it as, I am just repeating the previous result. This is K over omega mu naught into N hat cross E. And you know this omega over K is actually equal to the phase velocity. Omega over K is equal to C, because in this, in free space, the phase velocity of electromagnetic wave is represented by the symbol C. So omega over K is equal to C, and this is actually the phase velocity of this wave, phase velocity of EMW in free space. And in our expression, there exists K over omega. So this will be 1 over C. And so you can write it as N hat cross E over C into mu naught, C into mu naught. And again, you can see, we know that C square is equal to 1 over mu naught epsilon naught. We have just found this relation in the previous lecture. So what you can see from here? So if we find C into mu naught, this will be 1 over C into epsilon naught. So 1 over C into mu naught will be equal to C into epsilon naught. So equivalently, this expression can be written as C into epsilon naught into n hat cross E. H equal to this much. And this result may also be written as, if we multiply this mu naught to the factor H, what will be our result? This will be simply n hat cross E over C. This is also a very important result. And you know, mu naught into H is magnetic induction B. So this is B equal to n hat cross E over C. This is also a very important result, B equal to this much. And from here you can see, if we find the value of magnetic induction B, what will be this? Mod of B will be mod of n hat cross E over C. And as you know, n hat means a unit vector in the direction of k, and k is perpendicular to E, so n hat is also perpendicular to E as the wave is transverse. And so modulus of n hat cross E will be simply E, because this will be 1 into E into sine 90, and that is simply E. And so this is E by C. This is a very important result. You can see the magnitude of magnetic induction B is C times lesser than the magnitude of electric field in plane electromagnetic wave in free space. Therefore, B is much smaller than C. This is also a very important property of the plane electromagnetic wave traveling in free space. Now, using these results, we can find the ratio of the modulus of electric field vector and the magnetic field vector. So now you can find it. Now, mod of E over H, what will be this? You know, E is actually equal to E naught E to the power I K dot R minus omega t. And H is H naught E to the power I K dot R minus omega t. And you know, modulus of E to the power I theta is equal to 1. And so modulus of E to the power I K dot R minus omega t will be 1. And simply we will see that this is equal to mod of E naught by mod of H naught. And conveniently you can write it simply as E naught by H naught. And so this implies mod of E, you can write it as mod of E by mod of H, or you can take directly the mod of these two, ratio of these two vectors. So this is E naught over H naught. And using the previous result, you can see here what will be this. since you see here that this H is equal to N cross E over C mu naught. So if we will take the ratio of these two vectors, this will be simply equal to what? This will be actually C into mu naught. And again, as I have shown you previously, that C into mu naught is equal to 1 over C into epsilon naught. So we can write these two results in this manner. Now again, you know that this C square is equal, or you can say C is equal to 1 over root over mu naught into epsilon naught. So let us put the value of 1 over C. So what will be this? This will be 1 over epsilon naught into root over mu naught into epsilon naught. And so you can see from here, this will be root over mu naught over epsilon naught. So we are seeing here that the ratio of the magnitude of electric field vector and the magnetic field vector H is equal to a universal constant, because you know this mu naught and epsilon naught have a fixed values in free space. These are in fact universal constants. And let us denote this ratio by a particular symbol Z naught. And what will be the equation number? Let this is equation 4. Now we will see what will be what is actually this quantity Z naught. You can see from here, since the ratio of modulus of E and H is equal to root over mu naught into epsilon naught, and you know mu naught and epsilon naught are real and positive quantity. So this ratio will be definitely real and positive. And as I have told you, if the ratio of the magnitude of these two vectors is real and positive, what does it refer? It refers that E and H both are in same phase. And when you say that these two vectors are in same phase, I have told you, what does it mean? It means when E is maximum, then H will be also maximum. And when E will be minimum, then H will be also minimum. So they are following the same phase. So let us write this conclusion from here. You can see. So the the ratio mod of E by mod of H is what? It is real and positive. So E and H are in same phase. And when we say that E and H are in same phase, it means that is E has its maximum value, H has also its maximum. H has also its maximum. And we can see from here that the electromagnetic wave, the amplitude of electric field vector E and the amplitude of magnetic field vector H are not same, but their ratio is equal to a particular quantity, which is equal to Z naught. We will also identify this. But when we say that when E is maximum, H is maximum, similarly you can say when E is minimum, then H is minimum. And this fact actually refers that in case of electromagnetic wave traveling in free space, both of these two vectors oscillate in same phase. Let us see this fact by this figure. You can see, let us say, this is the direction in which wave is propagating, and you can see from here, let us say this is the direction along which electric field vector is oscillating, and at this moment when electric field vector points in this direction and is at its particular maximum value, then magnetic field vector H is also maximum. This is the direction of H. And here the direction of oscillation is just reversed. So you can again see this is the direction of vector E and this is the direction of vector H. So from this figure it is evident that E and H are oscillating in same phase. Now actually we will identify the quantity Z naught. You know this Z naught is equal to root over mu naught over epsilon naught. First of all, we want to identify the nature of this quantity, and for this we will find the unit of this quantity. You know the unit of mu naught is what? This is in fact Henry per meter, and the unit of epsilon naught is farad per meter, and you can write it as ohm into second over coulomb per volt. Coulomb per volt, and this will be actually equal to ohm into volt over ampere. You can see second by coulomb is 1 over ampere. So this is ohm volt by ampere. And you know this volt per ampere is actually equal to ohm, because this will be the unit of resistance or impedance. So this is ohm square root, and so this will be actually equal to ohm. So SI unit of this quantity Z naught is ohm, and as its unit is ohm, so you can identify it as an impedance, since mu naught and epsilon naught are the properties of free space, and so it is called the intrinsic or characteristic impedance of free space. Why intrinsic? Because mu naught and epsilon naught are intrinsic property of the free space. So we can say that Z naught has units and dimensions. Units and dimensions of impedance. Impedance. It is known as intrinsic or characteristic. Characteristic impedance. Characteristic impedance of free space. Why of free space? Because mu naught and epsilon naught are intrinsic property of free space. Now you can find the value of this intrinsic impedance of the free space. So let us find it. Z naught is equal to mu naught over epsilon naught square root. And you know what is the value of this mu naught. Mu naught is actually 4 pi into 10 to the power minus 7. And you know what is 1 over epsilon naught. 1 over epsilon naught is 4 pi into 9 into 10 to the power 9, and it's a square root. So you can see from here, this will be simply 120 pi. And so if you will multiply 120 by the value of pi, this z naught will be 120 pi, and this will be almost equal to 377 ohm. So this is the intrinsic impedance of the free space, and you can see this is real and positive. So you can say the ratio of the magnitude of electric field vector E and magnetic and electric field vector E and magnetic field vector H is equal to 377 ohm. It means it is real and positive. And so we say that these two vectors oscillate in same phase while the wave is propagating in free space. But I have shown that the magnitude of these two field vectors are not equal. Actually, the magnitude of a magnetic field vector is C times lesser than the magnitude of electric field vector in free space. So this was a very important property. Now we will discuss another important property of the electromagnetic wave traveling in free space, and this is actually the property related to energy flow in this case. So now we will talk about energy flow. You know, energy flow is actually discussed in terms of Poynting vector, and we have already discussed in previous lectures in very detail this particular vector, that is Poynting vector. So to discuss or to know the energy flow in case of electromagnetic wave traveling in free space, let us start from the definition of Poynting vector for this wave. So you know the Poynting vector for a plane EMW, which means electromagnetic wave, particularly in free space. Free space is given by, we know this is given as S equal to, we denote the pointing vector by the symbol S, and you know this is equal to E cross H, E cross H, and this will be E cross H. Just in the previous section we have seen that this H vector is equal to what? This is actually equal to N hat cross E over C into mu naught. And let us simplify this result. This is just E cross N hat cross E is just a triple vector product. And so from the definition of triple vector product, we can write this numerator in this way. This will be actually equal to E dot E into N hat minus E dot N hat into E and over C into mu naught. Now you know as our wave is a transverse wave, and so this E is perpendicular to N hat, and when E is perpendicular to N hat, you know that the scalar product of N E and N hat will be equal to zero. So this second term will actually vanish, and again E dot E is simply E square, so we can write the pointing vector S is equal to 1 over C into mu naught into E square into N hat. And equivalently, we may write it in this way. You know, 1 over C into mu naught, we have shown previously that this is equal to C into epsilon naught. So this result may be written in this way. This is C into epsilon naught into N hat. And again, we have seen that this C into epsilon naught or 1 over C into mu naught is actually equal to 1 over Z naught. So in terms of the intrinsic impedance, this result may also be written in this way. So we can write this result in this way. And this result also gives a very important information. You know, the energy flow takes place in the direction of the pointing vector. And what is the direction of pointing vector? As you are seeing from here, S is in the direction of N hat. N hat. And N hat is in the direction of wave vector K. So S is parallel to K. What does it mean? It means when electromagnetic wave travels in free space, then the flow of energy is in the direction of wave propagation. This is a very remarkable fact. So I am just writing this important fact in short. So in this case, energy flows in the direction of wave propagation. Wave propagation. Or you can say the pointing vector is in the direction of wave propagation. Somebody thinks that this is just a obvious thing, but not. You will see later on in different medium, like in case of anisotropic dielectric, the energy flow does not take place in the direction of wave propagation. In that case, in case actually the pointing vector does not point the direction of k, but in free space we are seeing here that s is along the direction of wave propagation. Now the value of pointing vector defined above, just we have defined, is actually its instantaneous value. Now we want to find its average value. So now the average value, average value of the pointing vector, average value of the pointing vector, we denote the average value by this symbol. Inside this bracket we write s, and you know this will be actually equal to what? Since s is equal to epsilon naught into c into e square, so we will take its average value, or since we know that this epsilon naught into c is a constant, so take it out from the sign of average. This is epsilon naught c modulus of e square, modulus of e square. And equivalently, you know this epsilon naught into c is actually equal to, and write n hat for its direction. So this is n hat. And you know epsilon naught into c is equal to 1 over z naught. So we can write this expression as 1 over z naught average value of e square into n hat. This is expression for the average value. Now we will find, or you will evaluate, what is the value of average value of e square. You know we can find it easily, that this e square, average value of e square, it means this will be the average value of e naught into e to the power I k dot r minus omega t, and its average value. And you know e to the power I theta is equal to cos theta plus I sin theta, and so we can take either the real part of this factor or its imaginary part instead of it. So this will be simply equal to e naught square, and average value of cos square k dot r minus omega t, k dot r minus omega t. Or you may write sin square k dot r minus omega t, taking the imaginary part. This is actually its real part. And we know the average value of cos square theta for a complete cycle is 1 by 2. So this will be simply equal to e naught square by 2. This is e naught square by 2. And we can write it in this way. This is e naught over root 2 into e naught over root 2. And you know e naught over root 2 is actually equal to e rms, and so this will be e rms square. And hence you can conclude that this point, average value of this pointing vector s is actually equal to what? This will be actually equal to epsilon naught into c into ई आर एम एस स्क्वायर इंटू एन हैट, और वी मे राइट इट एज वन ओवर जेड नॉट ई आर एम एस स्क्वायर इंटू एन हैट. सो दिस इज द एवरेज वैल्यू ऑफ द पॉइंटिंग वेक्टर. सो फ्रॉम हियर वी कैन कंक्लूड दैट द फ्लो ऑफ एनर्जी इन ए प्लेन इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक वेव इन फ्री स्पेस इज इन द डायरेक्शन ऑफ प्रोपेगेशन. I have just shown you that the instantaneous value of s is parallel to n hat, and we also see here that the average value of the pointing vector is also parallel to n hat. So we conclude from here that the energy flow in plane wave traveling in free space takes place in the direction of propagation of wave. So this is a remarkable property or a remarkable fact. Now finally we will discuss energy density in this case. So in the fifth property we will discuss the energy density. You know, when you talk about energy density in electromagnetic field, in this case actually the field has both electric energy and the magnetic energy. So we can say in case of plane electromagnetic wave, the static energy density, or you can say electrostatic energy density and magnetostatic energy density, both are present. So we know what is the density of electrostatic energy. Density of electrostatic energy. Density of electrostatic energy. This is denoted by symbol UE, and we have learnt that this is half epsilon naught E square, and density of magnetostatic energy. This is denoted by UM, and you know this is half mu naught H square. In previous lectures we have seen that these expression for energy density for electrostatic energy and magnetostatic energy are actually valid in case of electromagnetic situation too. So we have written the same expression even in the case of electromagnetic situation. So now let us take the ratio of these two energy density. We have to compare these two densities. So for that we take it their ratio UE over UM, and let us put the values of UE and UM from here. You can see this factor half will cancel out, and this will be simply epsilon naught E square by mu naught H square, and this is epsilon naught by mu naught, and we know the ratio of E by H is equal to ratio of E naught by H naught, and this is equal to in fact Z naught. This is equal to Z naught. So here we can write that this E over H is equal to Z naught, and so this will be Z naught square. And again, we know that this z naught is equal to root over mu naught by epsilon naught. So z naught square will be simply mu naught by epsilon naught. So this is epsilon naught by mu naught into mu naught by epsilon naught. So you can see from here, this will cancel out, and therefore we conclude that the ratio UE by UM is equal to 1. And if it is 1, what does it mean? It means UE is equal to UM. UE is equal to UM. So in this case, the electric energy density and magnetic energy density are equal. Now again, we are going to find the value of the ratio of point, average value of Poynting vector and the energy density, we will find it. So now average value of S over average value of U. What will be this? Actually, you know the average value of S is what? This is in fact epsilon naught into C into E RMS square n hat. We have just derived this result. And U means total energy density, and this is actually, it will be actually equal to epsilon naught E RMS square. And so what will be this? This E RMS square will also cancel out, and this is simply equal to C into n hat. So from here you can say, if instead of this average value we take the instantaneous value, even then this result will be valid. So this S is equal to simply C into U into n hat. This is also a very important result. And what does this result imply? Actually, it implies that the electromagnetic energy in free space is transmitted with a speed c, and with which the field vectors E and H also do. So you can say electromagnetic energy, electromagnetic energy in free space is transmitted with the speed of light C, with which field vectors E and H do. So these were all about the propagation of electromagnetic wave in free space. I am concluding all the important facts which we have just discussed. I am just repeating it in very short. You have seen that the wave propagation takes place with a speed which is equal to a speed of light C in free space. The another important fact we have just discussed, that the in case of the propagation of electromagnetic wave in free space, the electromagnetic waves are of transverse nature. Again, we have found that the wave vectors E and H are mutually perpendicular, and at the same time these two vectors are in phase with E and H, both are in same phase. Although magnitude of electric field vector is C times greater than the magnitude of magnetic induction B. And we have also shown that the electrostatic energy density is equal to magnetostatic energy density, that is UE equal to UM. And again, we have found that the electromagnetic energy is transmitted in the direction of wave propagation at a speed of C. So these facts we have discussed in this lecture. Now in next lecture, we will discuss the propagation of plane electromagnetic wave in isotropic